concepts of preservation and conservation of library materials. Okay, so how do we preserve and conserve library material? So there is a difference between preservation and conservation actually. So both looks same, but there is a, what do you say, subtle difference. We both use this synonymously. That means we both use this similarly in the terms of in the context of same meaning, but what do you say, they are somewhat different. So the distinction between preservation and conservation is unclear, to be honest. That is true actually, and we exactly don't know where we are actually using, when do we use preservation, when should we use conservation actually. So in the 1980s, the library and archival community have used preservation as an umbrella. Umbrella term is a common term, okay. In 1980s, the library and archival communities, they have used this. Activities that reduce or prevent damage to the extended life expectancy of collection. What is the life expectancy of collection? For example, this book will not be damaged for 3 years. The book will not be damaged unless you throw it or you tear it. That is a normal life expectancy, okay. Okay, that is a normal life expectancy of a book which is neatly handled. Okay, so it is a term that reduce or prevent damage to extend. So if you want to extend it further, means you have to use it properly. The things that are doing to reduce to increase the life expectancy of a particular document or collection is called as preservation. Conservation is specifically referred to treatment of damaged items. That means a book is already damaged. Okay. Now what you have to do is, you have to put some sellotape or something, whatever happens. What happens when you are using a note, printed book, one page is torn, means what you will do? You will put a sellotape or something or a gum or whatever it may be, and you will try to bring it back to the best shape, right? So that part is called conservation. That is prevent, and sometimes they use preventive conservation. See, they are using preventive conservation to describe broad collection that supports longevity of artifacts, records and monitoring. So that means the main is, when you are using the combination of both, means you are ensuring that it is not damaged, and once it is damaged also you have to ensure that it lifelong, it is longevity, it is life expectancy is increased. What do you mean by life expectancy? Normally the age of dogs is around 8 to 9 years, right? So if you give good food and if you take care of the dog very well, what happens? There is a chance that it will live to 10 to 12 years, right? That means you are increasing the life expectancy. Similarly, if you treat the book and treat the resources collection very well, you can automatically increase the expectancy. So there is one more term called restoration. It is in the restoration usually used in the context of museum objects, right, or motion pictures. Process of returning an object to the original state. Restoring, you are returning it. Please restore this book in good condition. So you are taking a book from the library and the library staff says like this: please restore the book in good condition, in the original condition. That means you should not write anything inside the book, you should not tear it, and you should not damage or mutilate any part of the book. So how you are taking from the library, you have to restore it, return or keep it in the same way. So that is called restoration. Okay. So this is the common terms used, and sometimes they might ask these questions also. So please remember, though they are similar, but there is some difference, right? So the protection of activities through minimum and chemical physical deterioration and damage that prevents the loss of informational content. Okay, the primary goal is to prolong is extend the existence of cultural property. Okay, conservation is, it is devoted to the preservation of cultural property for the future. Okay, it activity includes examination, treatment, preventive care also. Okay, preservation is you are preserving by it, in the farming they will use some chemicals to preserve from insects, right? So they are preserving it for lifelong in order to make sure the crop is not damaged. Similarly, you are using some chemicals or some physical deterioration to minimize chemical this thing. You are doing some steps to preserve it, increase the longevity, prolonging, extending, all are same only. Conserving is storing it and for future use. In normal terms, according to that library archival committee, what they are saying is, preserving is you are taking care so that you are giving, let us say this example from the dog point of view. The normal age of a dog is 8 years, but you are taking very good care of the dog, giving good food, that too in correct time. You are taking care of the dog very well, so that normal age from 8, it extends to 12 actually. So that means you are increased the age of the dog by 4 years. What you are doing here, you are preserving, you are preserving the good health of the dog. Similarly, here you are taking steps to preserve the good condition of the books, okay, in order to increase the book is normally this paper will long for only 2 years, sir. They are saying like that. So when you are giving some good treatment, taking care properly, the book comes for more than 1 year, 4 years, 3 to 4 years. So that means you are increasing. So conservation is, once a book has been damaged, you wanted to bring it back to the same condition, right? So book is, my page has been torn, you are conserving or you are putting some treatment to it. So if the dog is injured, what will you do? You'll take to the doctor and give some medicine. Similarly, if the book is torn, so you will bind it or something, you're conserving it. Restoration is keeping it back in the original condition. So please remember this in the common context. What is the need for preservation? We all know, why should we preserve? What is the need for preservation? If you don't preserve, it will automatically get spoiled. Simple. That is the main need actually. So decay from the aging of materials. Okay. So over a period of time, if you keep the book in the same place for a long period, what will happen? It will be decayed, right? So you have to prevent that from the aging of materials. So damage from use, raw materials of history. Okay. The old material constitutes the raw material and provides background information. I told you, right? Raw materials of history. The East India Report in Kandimura Public Library, that is a raw material of history, that is a first-hand resource. If we lost that book, what will happen? We cannot get it back. We cannot remake another book. That is the original source. So raw material of history must be preserved, right? Whatever measure you take it, you have to preserve it. So wide range of uses, right? Everyone, let it be a child or an old man, from layman to researcher. So information, even have 100 years of the publication of the material, that will be good actually. On continuous and future use, rare materials. So these are the main need. These are the considerations for the need of preserving and conserving library resources. Okay. What are the strategies and how will you preserve? What are the strategies you will adopt to preserve your library, preserve and conserve your library materials? So selection of the document at risk. First, you need to identify what are the documents are in bad condition and what are the documents you think they are going to get bad, they are going to get spoiled. So you have to select that document appropriately. Choosing method, that means custodial use function. So which option is best? For some options, binding would be better. For some options, other treatments would be better. So depending upon the nature of the document and the nature of the damage of the document, you have to ascertain which method is best for custodial and use function, right? So after conserving, you have to make sure that the book is used again. Okay, so for that, which method is better? And we have to prepare a budget, okay? So for this preservation and conservation, for binding and whatever, restoring, whatever process you are doing, you need to ascertain there is budget for the same, and you need to ascertain how much it will, how many books you are going to do that, and what are the procedures you have selected, and what will be the approximate cost for this. So you have to prepare a budget plan, okay? So necessary infrastructure, right? So according to whatever option you have chosen, you should be having the necessary infrastructure. So in case of digital preservation means you are storing, you are scanning the book, means there should be a good scanner, okay? There should be a good scanner with supporting softwares and hardwares, right? Not a normal scanner. There should be a good scanner for capturing the book without losing any content. That is very important. So infrastructure is very much essential. So formation of conservation laboratory. In a library, there should be a conservation laboratory. That means there should be a separate lab. Okay. Separate lab for the treatment. For the treatment and scientific analysis of the works, whatever books it may be. So that these books should be kept in that lab. And for treating those books, you can take those books to the lab. And in that lab, you can treat it. So if you have a separate lab or room for that, it will be convenient. Okay. So these are the strategies you should ensure that for preserving and conserving library materials. What are the different factors in the deterioration? What do you mean by deterioration? Deterioration is nothing but making it bad, making it worse. Already the condition is bad. Again, it is deteriorating, means my health is deteriorating. You might have heard this. My wound or my health is deteriorating. That means my health is getting bad actually. Okay, health is getting bad. Day by day, it is not improving. Deterioration means it is not improving. Okay, these are the terms you need to know actually. These are vocabularies. Prolong, extend. Okay, prolong, extend. Longevity, extend. All are same only. Increasing the life usage. Deterioration, worse, making it worse. My health is deteriorated. It's deteriorating day by day. That means my health is not improving. It is getting bad only. So generally, poor handling. What are the factors? When will the book will be in a bad condition? You can itself tell. Okay. So poor handling or storage. The book should be handled with proper care and softly. If you pull the book hardly and if you turn the pages very harshly or softly, ultimately with one or two or three times the pages will start to, pages will start to have the effect and it will tear automatically. So poor handling definitely, or storage, theft or vandalism. Theft means stealing the books and vandalism means they are just spoiling it. Okay, they are just spoiling it. And fire, not only fire, this is an unnatural disaster. Fire, if there is any fire in the library, what will happen? Everything will be spoiled. Flood and water. Okay, pollution. So, incorrect temperature, relative humidity, and these are some of the common factors. But these factors can be categorized into the following types actually. Climatic, chemical, types of insects, human beings, disasters. So, we will see this with some specific examples also. Chemical factors, what do you mean by chemical factors is usually paper. Usually paper, in order to maintain a paper size of paper like A4 or A3, whatever size, they will use some chemical components like alum, rosin. In order to maintain the actual size and the thickness and the quality of paper, they will use chemical components. What happens is, over a period of time, these chemical components which is used in this paper, in rosin or alum, what happens is, over a period of time, it causes acidic effects over a period of time. Okay, and if the atmosphere, if the library is having atmosphere if the library is having some oxides of carbon or sulfur, and it will get interacted with the paper, and automatically the chemical effects will take place, and automatically it will deteriorate the condition of the paper. It will make the paper worse over a long period of time. Okay, so once if it is a new book, the condition will be good. So over a period of time, the acidic reaction takes place, and slowly the effects of oxygen and the carbon dioxide, whatever it may be, the sulfurs, the nitrogen, which is present in the air, when it meets with the paper which contains alum and rosin, they create an acidic reaction, and this reaction is bad for the paper. So it takes time actually. So if the paper is having some chemicals, and definitely it will have chemicals, and over a period of time these chemical factors will come into play, the acidification process, everything will come into play, and ultimately what will happen, the book will be damaged. Okay, so these are the chemical factors. Insects, many insects, right? You might have heard of insects like beetles, termites, ants, book lice, bookworms. So they will spoil the book, they will store it, they will stay in the book, and they will eat the pages, they will tear the pages. You might have seen some damage based on the insects, right? Termites are injurious enemies of books. They eat books actually, they eat papers, catalog cards, everything. They will create a hole in that. So silver fishes can destroy the bindings also. Okay, so if you search the images for this, you will identify damage of book use by silverfish, damage of books by termites. You search in the internet, you will definitely find some good images how these insects are damaging. So book lice, they are very small insects, and maybe presence in thousands in two pages, there will be thousands of book lice. We cannot see it actually, it's very small. Okay, in a musty book they are asking. So they will damage actually. So how they can be avoided? You have to use some ethylene or whatever it may be, or carbon dioxide or formaldehyde vapors to remove those. And bookworms include the larvae of beetles. So these are the different kinds of insects that can damage book. So in some books they will keep neem leaves or tobacco leaves for the longevity of the book. And rodents, what do you mean by rodents? They are mice, squirrel, rats. If they come into the library, they will definitely tear the books. If a squirrel comes into the library, they will definitely tear the books, right? When a cat comes into the library, what will happen? It will tear the pages, right? So they'll eat and destroy, and these are, though the fungi are not the insects, they are injurious to document. They grow in humidity and they form a thin whitish coating of consisting many kinds of fungi. When you are working in a historical library or a library with some historical importance, or a library which is developed from a long period of time, you will definitely face this issue. There will be books like this actually. So you need to understand how to overcome this. Okay. For beetles, what they will do is they will tunnel through the paper. They will put a hole in the paper. Okay. They will put a hole in the paper. So you have to use this solution, Gemaxin or DDT solution, or naphthalene balls are to remove this. Okay, so these are different kinds of insects and their types of damage and what are the solution to remove it. Okay, remove those insects, pigmentation, naphthalene balls, everything, DDT powder. Okay, these are the different kinds of insects. See, I have given this in a tabular form for your better understanding. Okay, so kindly go through this and kindly find an image for each insect and see the images in Google. Okay, so how damn, what kind of damage they can do. So apart from these insects, these are things which we cannot avoid actually. That are common. We can just take preventive measures by adding some chemical or some solutions to this. But this is should be avoided, or the mutilation or the damage done by the human being should be avoided. Okay. That means as a library staff, we should be careful in using the books. Similarly, we should instruct the users how to properly, carefully handle the books. Okay, how to give due importance. Some users, they will come and they will take the book and throw away in the table and they will just go. It should be avoided. It is definitely damageable, right? So human damage caused to library resources by human should be avoidable. Okay, they sometimes damage reading material by misplacing, mutilating, theft of documents, everything. They will do this. Okay, this should be avoided from our point, right? So these are the precautions what we can take. So important books and manuscript, you should keep it in a separate. If there is only one copy of that book, that is you feel that is important, like I told you, like East India Report, I cannot keep it in the general section because everyone will come and look at it, right? So I have kept it in a separate section. Only authorized users are allowed. Okay, only when they request, and they will be handled with the help of a library staff only. So that means important books, you should give a special conservation. So it should be kept in a special container. It should not be for general reading. For carrying large number of books, a trolley should be used. If you carry it by hand, it will be difficult. Automatically, one or two books will fall out. It will be damaged. So trolley is best. So these are the common, right? These are the common precautions you should follow. It might look simple, but this is, if you give importance to this, you can definitely restore and conserve, preserve and conserve the longevity of the library materials, which is very important actually. Okay. Fine, avoid licking, that everyone will do that. Avoid licking of fingers in 8 to 10 pages. When turning pages, most people have the habit of licking their tongue, licking their finger in the tongue. That is very bad actually, okay. Automatically, it will spoil the content of the paper also. So these are the common behaviors and common ethics you can follow to preserve. And you can write this in the rules also. In the library rules and the library also, you can paste. You can prepare a board. You can prepare a notice board for this and you can display this also. So that the readers will understand. Oh, these are the things we should follow. Okay. So common disasters, I told you about fire, flood. These are unnatural. A fire accident, what will you do? Nothing we can do. Right. And if it is a fire accident, nothing we can do. And if it is a flood, what we can do? But we can take some precautions, right? Using of water bottles, or using of matchsticks, or using open flame items. Anything should be disallowed in the library. You should not allow it. And eating in the library, and chemical materials in the library, and these things should be definitely disallowed in the rules and regulations. We can take precautions only. But in terms of natural or unnatural disasters, we cannot do anything. But we can take some necessary precautions. Even if the flood comes, and if the books are kept in a high rack, so at least only a minimum portion will be damaged. So you have to plan for everything. You have to be prepared for everything. So even though 100% damage cannot be saved, at least you can limit the damage to a minimum percent, minimum extent, right? So for that, certain preparation should be there. Emergency gate must be clearly indicated. Electrical effects, wiring shortage, fire, or whatever it may be. So everything should be maintained. So if you have a collection of digital materials of all these books, it will be better also. So if when the print books get damaged, you will definitely have the digital copy, right? So these are the common ways you will preserve it, right? So these are the common points. So please make a note of it. Again, the same points repeated in different paragraphs. They're given in different contexts, right? Evaluation of heavily used, fragile and rare located history and logical, genealogical material should be made to determine what materials need to be preserved, right? You should understand, you should evaluate which materials are highly used, which materials are fragile. What do you mean by fragile? Easily breakable. Glass is fragile when compared to plastic. Because if I not handle the glass tumbler, what will happen? If I leave it, it will easily break. In case if I drop a plastic tumbler, it will not break. So that means glass is fragile. Fragile means easily breakable. So that means a book in bad condition is easily torn. It is easily damaged. Okay, this book should be given due importance and due care. Okay, so photographic prints in a. If you are having video resources, OHPs, open edge projectors, or what are slide tapes, and these are photographic images, and you should preserve it carefully, right? Okay, rare location, historical material should be given due care actually. So please make a note of this. And the preservation, commonly I told you what is preservation, conservation and restoration. So there are only two types of, commonly there are two types, preventive and curative. Preventive is whatever it is happening before it is damaged, you are preventing it for longevity, increasing the lifespan of the periodicals. That is preventing. Curative is increasing the life expectancy of damaged by of cultural property. It includes binding, fumigation. You are curing it. Okay, you wanted to increase it by curing it. There is a disease and you wanted to take medicine by curing it. Simple. So preventive is to have a good health, you are running, going for jogging. That is preventing. If you run means your health will be good. Your heartbeat rate will be good. Heart rate will be good. Everything will be good. Your cardio system will be good. So after you are getting a fever, you are going to the doctor for curing. Okay, you are taking a medicine for curing. Okay, to increase your lifespan and also to reduce the fever. So these are the different preventive. This you can relate it with the books also. With the books also, preventing it for you are regularly maintaining, regularly checking, changing the naphthalene balls or hitting the sprays and solutions for in order to prevent insects. And once a book is little bit damaged, you are binding it, fumigating, whatever you are doing it for curing it. So binding, you all know what is binding, right? Yeah, in school days we definitely bind our books, right? So in most of the library there will be a separate binding section. Okay, whichever books which is torn or which is important, which needs to be preserved, and they will definitely cure it with the binding. It may include different prospects. I am not going in detail with it. Mending, separation, they will tear the pages and again they will bind it together, loosening. Okay, loosening. Please make a note of that. Sometimes they might ask it. Reinforcing, repairing. These are common terms only. Fine. So deacidification, acidic book papers. I told you that acidic chem paper, they will have alum and rosin, right? Sometimes rexin papers are there, some papers are there. What will happen is when it opens in the atmosphere, the automatically the nitrogen and what is carbons which is available in the air, they will get connected with the acidic nature of the paper and acidification process will come. And if you use some chemicals or something like that, it will go away. It will prolong it. That's it. So now chemists are working in the process of creating an acid approach to the problem of acid degradation of paper. So deacidified papers have been developed and used, and they are gently costly actually. That's true. Especially if they involve a single sheet treatment process requiring, for example, dismantling the book. Okay. So for deacidifying a paper, you need to dismantle the entire book. That is costly, right? So there are new processes developed that characterize as mass vapor deacidification through the use of special chemical. They will just put the chemical, diethyl zinc. Remember this, DZ, diethyl zinc. The process involves loading book into a vacuum chamber, evacuating air into the vacuum chamber and the moisture from the book. That's good actually. There will be a vacuum chamber. They will put the book inside the vacuum chamber. And the air, the DZ, the diethyl zinc will be evacuating air from the chamber, and automatically it will moisture the paper of the books inside the chamber, and after everything done, it will come outside as a clean one. So this is the treatment they are following it for deacidifying the books. Okay, So this is costly actually, but the chemists are working on the product. Fugmentation is nothing but it's a gaseous process under controlled conditions to inhibit microbiological growth and insect investigation of reading materials. We saw about insect and rodents, right? So they will use some chemicals or gases in order to avoid the insects damage in the library material. Enclosing the objects to be treated to atmosphere of dimol vapor by general heating of dimol crystals to a longer period to assure exposure of all parts of the objects. So generally it uses as a preventive to control fungi. They will eat certain parts of they will heat in the vapor, not in the fire actually, dimol vapor, they will heat it to a certain temperature that a little bit of heat is transferred to the book so that it automatically kills the fungi. So this is called as fugmentation. Remember that lamination, we all know what is lamination, right? Laminated sheet, sticking of sheets, tissue, whatever it may be. Microfilming also we know, it is least expensive method. It is filmed. In the earlier stage, they will have a cyclic type of film where they will roll the handle in order to film screen by screen. Now we are using digital filming, but now earlier days it was microfilming. Okay, two silver handles on negatives and one copies are made. So when you go and see in the internet what is microfilming, you will definitely understand. When you see the picture, you will understand. So these are some of the techniques, right? This is the microfilm. So once you film, it will be stored like this. This is an image of microfilm, right? It is stored in the form of a film actually. Okay, like what do you call it? It is a copy. It's a microfilm copy. Negatives will be there and a copy will be made in the library. Photocopying is nothing but Xerox. Taking Xerox. Okay, it's the least acceptable. It is you are taking Xerox of the particular book or something which is damaged. Photography, you know, refurbishing. I have told you about this concept, but again, I'll brief it. Cleaning, including the application of leather, dressing, minor repairs, everything, okay? So refurbishing is you are restoring it, cleaning it, and bringing it back to the original condition and slowing the rate of deterioration. That is very important. Refurbishing is also a type of preventive. You are preventing it. You are preventing it. That means before it is damaged, you are preventing it. That is refurbishing. Digitization, we all know that either we type it or we use a scanner to digitize the physical documents into digital objects, right? So this is how a scanner will look like. Or it's a good scanner. You have to use a good scanner. When you are working for a library, you definitely ask for a very good scanner, okay? Then only you can get the content with good quality. You cannot use CAM scanner or basic scanners for digitizing library documents, okay? So these are the digital media and preservation techniques, okay? So digital technology is also what you say. You have to preserve digital contents also. Some not only printed books, you have to preserve digital contents also. That means migrating, emulating. Okay. So sometimes digital obsolescence will be there. Over a period of time, certain documents will be erased actually. Contents will be allowed. In Gmail, what happens is if you delete a mail, it will be stored in trash for 30 days. And after 30 days, it will automatically delete it, right? And if you definitely want that mail, if you forgot it by mistake, if you have deleted it, it will be there for 30 days. It will be stored, preserved in 30 days for trash. And if you still not moved it to inbox, what happens after 30 days will go. And after that, if you search, what will happen? It will definitely not be available. That means digital document has been eradicated, removed. You have to preserve that also if it is important. So the metadata attachment is very much important. These are the techniques actually. These are the techniques. And use of standard file format, according to the file format, let it be RTF or TIFF or whatever it may be, or PDF or Word, whatever it may be. Okay, it should be widespread, backward compatible, it can be easily upgradable, there should be conversion of file format should be easy. And if you store the document in different file format and standard file format, it will be easy to restore actually. Okay, avoiding physical restoration of media. The media on which digital content are stored. If you are storing this in a particular computer, means what happens if the computer goes, everything is gone. But if you are storing it in a cloud, means if one computer goes, you can always retrieve it based on the internet on another computer, right? So the digital media where you are keeping it, the server where you are maintaining it, should be properly maintained. So replication is duplicating, creating multiple copies. So if I sending an important document, means you create one more copy and save it in your mail or drive or whatever cloud form you are using, right? So even if I delete it, you can have all your own copy. So this is how you preserve digital content and refresh it. Transferring content between two types of storage medium. transferring contents to. What is the different types? One is CD and one is a pen drive. You can transfer the contents in CD also and to pen drive also. It is necessary due to the deterioration of physical digital media. Remember, if the CD is spoiled or if the CD is scratched, if it is in pen drive, means you can easily access it. Migration. What do you mean by migration? I have migrated myself from Chennai to Punjab due to my work. That is migration. Okay. The storage format of evolution. Migration is what happens is, sometimes what happens is, if Gmail, they saying that we are going to close Gmail and you have stored all your documents in Gmail, what will happen? You need to find another platform. So that means if you are storing in a good platform, if you are storing in a platform, if you are having the data in standard format, it is easy to migrate. So okay, no problem, I'll download it and I'll migrate it to Yahoo. Fine, I'll go to another platform which is convenient. So migration should be done. It is better to keep the data in two different modes actually. And then bit streaming and breaking up data. This is what you say, backing up, you have to keep a backup data wherever you get. Emulation is a software. It is a uses emulator software. It translates codes and instructions from one computing to another in a new platform so that the digital form can be viewed and sent. Okay, it is replicating the fractionality of functionality of obsolete system. So what do you say, emulating an Atari on Windows system or on WordPerfect in 1.0 on Macintosh. So what do you mean by that is, so I'm using Word 2015, you are using Word 2019 is, so according to the code, if I am using Word 2015 but you are using 2019, that means 2015 is not supported. But I want to share the document with you. If I want to share it, means if there is a code, there is an emulator code, and if I convert my content into that code, you can use it in multiple formats. Okay, so that is, emulator is a kind of software which helps to do this. Okay, and technology, you all know that digital archaeology, archaeological backups, okay, technological preservation, like repository, you can use repository. It deals with the preserving technology, including hardware, and you have to preserve the technology also. Okay, preserving the technology of the hardware, you have to preserve the hardware and software configuration. Procedures to rescue the content from damaged media, hardware or software. So if a computer is crashed, what will happen? If a computer is crashed, you have to take backup, right? You have to format it and you have to take backup. So that is called as digital archaeology. Analog backups is, it is a process of conversion of digital objects into analog format. It is useful for the document that has highest level of protection from being lost. If you convert it to analog, it will be, the storage will be long actually. So this is all about what you call preservation and conservation. So it is very much essential. Okay, in order to prolong the documents, it is very much essential. Even though the physical, we saw about the preservation and conservation techniques in both physical and as well as digital documents. Even though the documents are in digital format, still you need to follow certain techniques. You need to follow certain methods for long-term preservation of digital documents, like migration. You need to be more compatible with more than one tool. If you depend only on a single tool like Gmail or something like that, when Gmail is down, what will happen? You cannot do anything. So you should be dependent on more than one tool. You should be able to migrate it. You should be able to emulate it in different formats and different file formats. And you should know about variety of mechanisms that are helpful for digital preservation and as well as the mechanisms for preserving and conserving printed materials. So this is all about it. So kindly go through these references for a detailed session. Okay, detailed session, and this is sources where I took this particular presentation. So thank you.